Our next lecture is a bit on the short side. We're not going to be covering everything corresponding to the chapter for this week, but rather focusing on more cultural developments, other factors leading up to the Renaissance, beginning with the development of vernacular literary languages. So up until this point, the 14th century, and throughout most of the history of the Middle Ages, the language used for writing was predominantly Latin. So people spoke many different languages that today roughly correspond to Spanish, French, German, and so forth. But these were not literary languages. And that's kind of what we're talking about here. They were vernacular languages. So they were either vernacular or literary, but not both, right? So what that means is that the languages people spoke actually varied tremendously from one place to another. So there would be many dialects of what today we might call Spanish, French, German, and so forth. In fact, even today you have different dialects of these languages, though they tend to be dying out. So first of all, I should clarify what a dialect is. Dialect is a lot more than simply the idea of distinct accents. Dialects reflect the fact that inasmuch as the language being spoken is not a written language, there's very little in way of a formal grammar, formal rules about spelling, pronunciation, so forth, that are anchoring it down. And languages tend, if you don't actually do that, languages just tend to change over time. And in this case, as people who may have had a common point of origin, originally spoke a shared language, as they move further and further apart, whatever they're speaking is going to evolve in different directions. So you end up with dialects that very often are quite different from one another, to the point where they might even not be understandable. So for instance, today in the Middle East, most people speak Arabic, but most people speak dialects. So you have a Palestinian dialect, a Syrian dialect, an Egyptian dialect. You do have a formal literary form of Arabic, known as Fusha, or High Arabic, which corresponds to the Quran. There's even a kind of somewhat simplified version known as Modern Standard Arabic that would be used for instance, television broadcasts, in newspapers, and so forth. But most people actually speak dialect. And so, for instance, even if you're a native, in this example, Arabic speaker from Palestine, you might have difficulty understanding someone speaking Arabic who's coming from the Gulf region. Probably not Egypt, because Egypt produces a lot of film, so you'd probably be familiar with Egyptian dialect. But you kind of get the basic idea, and there's even variation from one village to another. Now, as I mentioned, in Europe, you still have dialects today. So, for instance, you do have a formal form of German known as Hochdeutsch, but in some parts of Germany, you might find kind of regional or localized dialects. That again, if you're not from that region, even if you're a native German speaker, you might have difficulty understanding. So, at what point did we develop formalized versions of German and Italian and Spanish and so forth? And that's kind of the development we're looking at here, where the languages that people actually spoke on a day-to-day basis are going to be transformed into literary languages, meaning that you're going to end up with, you might still have many different dialects, but you'll end up with one formalized version of that language that has a formal grammar, formal rules about spelling and pronunciation, so forth, and can provide the basis for writing. And so up until this point, again, mostly what was written in Latin. So only highly educated individuals would have been able to actually read and write. Usually people affiliated with the clergy or perhaps coming from a noble background, increasingly people coming from a bourgeois background. But coming into the 14th century, we're going to see the emergence of vernacular literary languages, the formalization of Italian, German, Spanish, English, and so forth, that will then become the language that people write in. They become literary languages. And very often when this happens, there is usually one or maybe several individuals that are extremely important with regard to this development. Usually the individual who you could argue is the first one to actually start writing in the vernacular language, right? Up until then, somebody who wanted to write something would have written in Latin. At some point, we're going to see increasingly individuals deciding to write in the vernacular language. And this ends up becoming the foundation for a much more formal version of the respective language. So in the case of Italian, right? So for instance, if you study Italian today at university, for instance, here at BMCC, you are learning the formal version of Italian that originated from the dialect used in Florence. And the individual most responsible for creating or laying the foundation, I should say, because it's going to evolve considerably from that point forward, but the individual most responsible for laying the foundation for a literary form of Italian would be Dante Alighieri. So he was a Florentine writer, and he was writing in the aftermath of the Black Death, which would really heavily influence the kind of writing people were doing, the themes they had. His masterpiece is the Divine Comedy. And so this is written in the Florentine dialect, but by virtue of using it to write something, it's becoming formalized. This will become the basis for a formal version of Italian where you have a very specific grammar, grammatical rules, spelling rules, and so forth. Some of you might have heard of the Divine Comedy. It basically talks about the different levels of hell and heaven by way of detailing the soul's progression to salvation. So it's written in a poetic form and divided into sections corresponding to hell. I should also say purgatory because he was Catholic, and then heaven or paradise. For our purposes, it is definitely a brilliant work of literature, but for our purposes, our primary interest is that this is laying the foundation for what will become a formal form of Italian. The development of formal Italian will continue under another Florentine poet who came a little bit after Dante, Francesco Petrarca. In English, we often refer to him as Petrarch, and he's probably best known for his vernacular sonnets, so kind of poetic form, about the woman he loved, Laura. So, you know, from a literary point of view, we should note this was in some ways very typical of a long-standing tradition in medieval literature, this kind of idealizing of a female individual. What's kind of interesting here is you really get a strong sense of who this Laura was. Very atypical in, you know, the fact that it reveals her individuality, her personality. And that is something that would have been unusual up until that point. And that might even reflect in part why Petrarch chose to write in Italian. You know, kind of a language that would have conveyed more of a sensibility of the individual he was writing about. This kind of development, of course, not happening only in Italy. In the case of English, probably the instrumental figure is going to be Geoffrey Chaucer, who lived roughly around the same time as Petrarch, most famous for his Canterbury Tales, which is actually a collection of stories, but he has this kind of device where you have a group of pilgrims who are headed to Canterbury, and on the way, in order to pass the time, each relates a different story. So, you know, apart from its importance in the development of the English language as a literary language, and it kind of takes as its base what would have been a Midland dialect, so that's kind of the ancestor of the modern English language as we know it today. But it also tells us a lot about the society at the time, because these stories really cover a broad range of individuals in terms of their social backgrounds. So you have stories about people who are high-born, also low-born. So, you know, very again, a very important literary work in and of itself, but also very important for understanding the development of the English language. And here we see an illustration kind of indicative of this mechanism that he uses to pull together all these different stories. We see these different individuals, all of them coming from different social backgrounds, traveling together as pilgrims and telling different stories. But of course, each story would have been appropriate to the social background of the individual telling it. And perhaps one last example of a vernacular language becoming a literary one, in this case, French, and the individual who played a very prominent role at the start, Christine de Pizan. Very interesting because it would have been very unusual for a woman to have been an author at this particular point in time, in large measure because most women did not have access to an education, even if born from a noble background. In this case, the only reason she received an education was because her father, who had a very important position at the court of the French king, Charles V, had actively promoted it. So also interesting is that she directly addressed issues that today we would characterize as feminist. She is best known for her prose works written in defense of women, probably the most important of which is The Book of the City of Ladies, written in 1404. And so, you know, the stereotype of women at that time was that they were basically silly individuals, that they were irrational, prone to emotional outbursts, prone to gossip. And so she was like, well, yes, there is something to this stereotype, but the reason women behave that way is because they are not permitted to get educated. If a woman had access to an education, she would not be inferior to men. And she, of course, is a very good example of exactly that. I mean, she kind of proves her own case. So at the start of the lecture, I mentioned we're going to look at a number of different factors, kind of laying the foundation for the Renaissance. One very important one that is addressed in much more detail than we're going to do here in the textbook, the Black Death. So one major impact it's going to have is it's really going to have a major impact on, kind of disruptive impact on medieval traditions related in particular to religion. Up until this point, most art had a religious theme, and that was kind of the purpose of art. To some extent, to deal with the fact that the vast majority of Europeans were illiterate. So it would be a way of kind of relating biblical stories, you know, kind of a way of educating people on, you know, right behavior, what God expects of you, of so forth, putting the fear of God in them as far as what will happen if you sin. Black Death is going to do a lot to undermine this, right? I mean, you know, it really undermines, you know, any kind of belief in a just God, that good things happen to good people, bad things happen to bad people, and so forth. The church is certainly going to be, is going to take a hit in the sense that it seems totally incapable of dealing with the devastation wrought by the Black Death. And that is going to play out in terms of art as well, where increasingly the themes are going to be secular. And a really good example of this kind of leading up to the Renaissance and kind of prefiguring some of what's going to happen then is an Italian artist named Giotto, right? So this is, again, he's from Florence, a Florentine. And when we get to the Renaissance, I think it will be quite apparent that Florence is going to be at the center of developments in Europe. But this is before the Renaissance, right? But a lot of what he's doing anticipates what is going to happen during the Renaissance. So kind of reflects the new direction that art is going to take moving forward. So here we see, you know, the best way to explain art, whether we're talking about the Renaissance or the period leading up to it, is by looking at actual works of art. Here we have a really illustrative example of what's going on with Giotto, a work known as Lamentation. Now, by the way, at this point, still kind of having a religious theme, but there are certain changes stylistically in terms of how the human form is presented, in terms of somehow conveying the individuality of different figures and so forth, that really reflect where things are headed when we get to the Renaissance, right? So two things I'd really focus on here, and this will become, these two things will become kind of the two chief concerns of Renaissance artists. The first has to do with this idea of depicting human anatomy, the human form, as accurately as possible, inclusive of also trying to capture a sense of, you know, the individuality of different, you know, different figures in the work of art, right? Kind of the idea that you try to capture the emotion of the scene, that something in the facial expressions would tell the viewer something about these individuals, what they're feeling at the time. So that's kind of part of it too. The second concern has to do with depth of perception, the idea that you really have a sense of who's closer, who's further away, and all points in between. And so still kind of imperfect at this point, but eventually, in large measure by using geometry, by the time we get to the Renaissance, artists, particularly in Italy, are going to be really good at capturing, in a very realistic way, a depth of perception, right? The way that, you know, presently a camera might capture it, or the human eye. So I would look at one more work of art from this period, also by an Italian artist, Francesco Traini, and this is his Triumph of Death. I think this one actually illustrates in a much more overt way the impact of the Black Death, you know, in terms of the kind of themes people were were painting or was informing their artistic work. So, you know, I suppose you could say, right? I mean, just looking at this painting, probably you wouldn't even need to know the title in order to understand that it somehow reflects the kind of devastation that was being wrought by the Black Death on Europe at this time. But I imagine, you know, you might think on the face of it that this is actually a rather religious theme, but this would not have been a typical subject matter for a painting up until this point. I mean, this kind of focus on what would appear to be the apocalypse, you know, the end of days. I mean, if you had a painting concerned with the end of days, it would have been about judgment. It would have probably centered on the role of Jesus in that regard. This really, when you look at this painting, you feel as if God has abandoned the earth pretty much, right? This is a pure scene of apocalypse. But I should note also, we talked about, you know, certain artistic concerns of Renaissance painters. So we can see that that is also a focal point here, particularly depth of perception. Just wanted to point that out. So still kind of working it out, but there really is this kind of concern with conveying in a realistic way, you know, what is in the foreground, what is in the background, and what everything that is, you know, constitutes points in between. So we're not going to talk much more about art at this point, but I do want to look at some other developments that, you know, in a way also reflect the secularization of Europe in the aftermath of the Black Death, some of these corresponding to medicine and health, right? So, you know, up until this point, the medical sciences, if you will, were not particularly highly developed in Europe. The Islamic world was certainly much further advanced in this regard. And part of this reflected that there was much greater concern for the spiritual state of being than the physical state of being. With the Black Death, there was, you know, kind of the inability of the church to deal with this and to, you know, somehow provide a convincing explanation for why this had happened, you know, that somehow would confirm that God is still active in this world and so forth. A lot of this would kind of underpin a growing recognition that this kind of problem wasn't really a spiritual matter, it was a health matter, right? Medical practitioners, whatever you had up until that point, and, you know, there had been this kind of idea that good health corresponded to some kind of balance of these four humors. You know, very often medical practice really didn't extend beyond things like using leeches to bleed people and maybe some herbs here and there. You know, some things that were kind of more spiritualistic in terms of you know, prayer or connected with saints and relics and so forth. You know, none of that obviously working. You did have surgeons up until that point. Surgeons, from our point of view, probably the closest thing to proper doctors, but they were at the bottom of the medical hierarchy at that point. After the Black Death, their stock is really going to go up, right? They're going to gain greater prominence. In large measure because they have a much more practical knowledge of the human body. And it very quickly becomes apparent that anyone who's able to achieve anything, if there's anyone who's able to achieve anything in terms of improving people's health, particularly in connection with the plague, they seem to be doing the best. And so what you're going to see is also with the emergence of universities. And that's another important development as we move towards the Renaissance, right? Kind of a new appreciation for learning. And these universities are going to stress a much more secular kind of education. Surgeons are going to be viewed as very valuable, many of them being recruited and developed. You see universities effectively developing medical programs. And we should also note within, you know, we talked about the revival of towns and cities before. As many of them become larger, there's going to be a greater focus on what today we'd call public health issues, you know, in terms of proper plumbing, in terms of how to deal with the outbreak of disease, you know, in terms of quarantining and so forth. In some cases, cities are even going to form special boards of health, right, to deal specifically with those kinds of issues. And speaking of towns, that brings us to another very important factor laying the foundation for the Renaissance, and that will be the continued expansion in trade, which we already touched upon a bit when we looked at the High Middle Ages. But this is going to continue, especially in Italy. Venice at some point becoming extremely wealthy and by extension powerful, but also in other Italian city-states like Florence, Milan, Genoa, even Rome. But also in the north, northern part of Europe, where the Hanseatic League will play a very important role in the north of what today is Germany. By 1500, more than 80 cities belonged to the League, which had settlements and commercial bases throughout many other cities that weren't even part of the League, for instance, in England and other parts of northern Europe. You know, so the League basically providing a basis for diplomatic exchanges. This would facilitate, for instance, banks setting up branches in different cities. All of this made trade much easier, right? Just kind of established very important links in that regard. And then all of this activity is going to tie into developments in the Mediterranean via the Venetian Flanders fleet. So kind of the point of connection is going to be the port city of Bruges, the southern outlet in Flanders. And this kind of becomes the economic crossroads of Europe. And just to visually give you an idea of what we're talking about with the Hanseatic League, this map isn't in English, but I think you can make out some of the names there. London would have been a part of the League. Bruges, you can see that kind of very near to London. We have an image of Bruges in the lower right-hand corner. You can probably also make out cities like Oslo, Hamburg, Danzig, which today is Gdansk, Riga, Tallinn, and so forth. Novgorod, which kind of connecting it with what will become the Russian Empire. So very important to the economic development of Northern Europe, but ultimately all of Europe benefiting. And in fact, by the 15th century, we can really talk of Europe as having experienced something close to a full economic recovery. But probably nowhere is doing better than Italy. Particularly Florence. At some point, Florence is really going to start to become maybe the wealthiest or certainly one of the wealthiest cities in all of Europe. Some of this reflects local industry, right? So a woolen industry develops in Florence, and they're able to kind of pick up whatever slack is left by Flanders or some of the other northern Italian cities. Other Italian cities are going to, and what you're kind of seeing here is different cities in Italy are becoming specialized in different kinds of economic activity. So that is one factor undermining their economic success. Some are specializing in silk wares, others glassware, for instance, Venice, even today still famous for its glass artifacts. Much of this has to do with kind of a luxury industry. And this is kind of the key point, right? The only reason there is a market for these kinds of goods is because increasingly people have disposable incomes, right? This is especially true with regard to this emerging social group, the bourgeoisie. These are individuals who, they have enough money that they can start spending it on things that aren't necessities anymore. And also, some of this is going to end up being used as capital to initiate other kinds of economic activity. For instance, in industries like mining, metallurgy, printing, for instance. So there's a lot going on economically, and at some point it's kind of feeding back into itself. Rulers start to get involved. They see the possibility of utilizing resources within their kingdom to make more money. So, for instance, transferring titles for underground minerals to financiers as collaterals for loans. And then these entrepreneurs are able to develop large-scale mining operations to produce things like copper, iron, and silver to some degree for the benefit of the ruler. But obviously, those individuals would make a profit as well. And of course, one very important industry that underpins many of these other activities would be banking. And one family coming into the Renaissance will stand head and shoulders above everyone else in this respect, and that will be the Medici family of Florence, who had started out with cloth production and then had expanded into commerce, real estate, and finally banking. And it was as bankers that they would really make their mark. During its heyday, the House of Medici was by far the greatest bank in Europe. It had branches throughout Italy, Venice, Milan, Rome, but also throughout Europe, in Avignon, in what today is France, Bruges, London, Lyon, also in France. They were also the principal bankers for the papacy. Now, you know, eventually their financial edifice would come to an end. It would collapse by the end of the 15th century, but they'd have a really good run of it in the meantime. And why am I highlighting them so much? Because if we're talking about disposable income, they would have money to burn, and they would use that money to patronize great art. And that will be a major driving factor behind Renaissance art. Artists like Michelangelo, Da Vinci, Raphael, names that many of you have heard, they did not produce art just for the sake of producing art, just for their own self-satisfaction. They were paid to produce very specific works of art, sculptures of specific individuals, paintings of very specific scenes. Of course, they would have tremendous leeway as great artistic giants in their time, in terms of where they went with that. But, they were paid to produce this art. And as often as not, it was a member of the Medici family that was doing the paying. We'll talk more about that when we get to the actual art of the Renaissance. For now, let's kind of consider the state of European society. With all these changes going on, it might surprise some people to know that the three estates is still intact, and the nobility are still the dominant element, but the nature of their function is really beginning to change, right? So they will continue to politically dominate, to some degree militarily, but also as kings develop bureaucracies and are no longer dependent on the cooperation of nobles who are fairly autonomous within their own regions, they will end up becoming part of those bureaucracies. They will hold the most important military and political posts. So there's still kind of the idea that you should be a good warrior, but nobles are now expected to have a very particular kind of education, what we might call a classical education, which has a lot to do not just with knowing how to do things, but also about how you behave, right? That you should have this kind of very well-developed personality so that you know how to interact with others in a social environment, right? So there is kind of this social ideal of the aristocracy, and usually corresponding to some individual that works for the king in his court, or for a prince, if you will, someone of lesser rank. But the basic idea is the nobles' ambition is to serve their prince as effectively and honestly as possible. And by the way, it's going to be this group. At some point we tend to refer to them more simply as aristocracy, the nobles, but they will continue to dominate European politics right up until the 20th century. Well, what about the third estate, right? The vast majority of people are still commoners, still members of the third estate, but something is really changing there. Whereas, the vast majority of commoners used to be peasants, that is no longer the case. I mean, they still do make up the majority, but it's not, it would have been originally, if you went back to even the high Middle Ages, it would have been, somewhere in the range of 95%. That's starting to change, right? Serfdom is still there, but in many cases, it's been eliminated. A lot of this has to do with the Black Death, which basically wiped out large numbers of peasants, which meant that there were fewer of them to go around. At some point, landlords are going to find it easier to take rents rather than payment in labor. Also considering that there's going to be a lot more fluctuation in terms of which peasants are actually living on your manor. What's also going to happen is in some cases, peasants are going to abandon their manor. So, imagine that you're a peasant living on a manor where so many peasants got wiped out by the Black Death that the manor is no longer functionable, right? It effectively has to be abandoned. Likelihood is you're going to end up in a town or city. So now you're kind of part of the growth of towns and cities, and eventually you become part of this other social group, the bourgeoisie. You're still a commoner, you're still part of the third estate, but the bourgeoisie don't really fit very well into the structure of the three estates in terms of what the role is of a member of the third estate, right? It used to be that your primary role was to provide the material needs of the other two estates, usually as a serf, right? Primarily producing food, but maybe also producing weapons for the knights, clothing, and so forth. You're now in business for yourself, in effect, right? You're engaged in some kind of economic activity that is basically about making money. Additionally, you're probably much more highly educated. And now it makes more sense to define your role in terms of where you fit into the town social structure. Are you a patrician, one of the wealthier, more important families that tend to govern in a town? Are you a petty burgher, someone with property, with you know a certain degree of status, probably educated, but you know not really among those that are actually involved in governing the town? Or are you a propertyless worker, aspiring to become one day a petty burgher, somebody with property? And so, you know, this is a really important development, particularly if we're talking about Flanders in the north in Italy, where, you know, this kind of development is going to be much more pronounced, where you're really going to see a large number of commoners now corresponding to the bourgeoisie. Having said that, we should note that in most of the center of Europe, particularly the further east you go, the peasantry is still going to be the dominant element. One very unfortunate societal level development leading up to the Renaissance is going to be the reemergence of slavery, which had more or less disappeared by the 9th century, which isn't surprising, you know, that during the Middle Ages, if you're a noble with loads of serfs working on your manor, why on earth would you buy a slave, right? But that is going to change beginning around the 11th century. Now, some of this had to do with the Black Death, which led to a shortage of workers. So slavery is going to become prominent really in places where feudalism and serfdom are starting to peter out, especially in Italian cities where slaves are going to be used basically to make up for that shortage of workers, usually as skilled workers, but sometimes as nursemaids or even playmates for one's children. So some of this just reflects the fact also that people have disposable income that they can use to buy slaves. So slaves for the Italian market, you might ask, where are they coming from? Initially, they're coming predominantly from the Eastern Mediterranean Black Sea, though from a very early point, some were obtained from Africa. So between 1414 and 1423, you have about 10,000 slaves that are being sold on the Venetian market alone, most of them females. By the 15th century, we're starting to see a shift whereby slaves are increasingly coming from Africa. So between 1444 and 1505, about 140,000 slaves being shipped into Europe, though by the 16th century, they had become more rare. Unfortunately, slavery will find a new market by that point in the New World, right? Particularly in connection with plantations, but that's another story. So one last thing we might discuss with regard to, might call it pre-Renaissance, Renaissance society, are changes related to the family. You might remember during the High Middle Ages, the fundamental family unit would have been the nuclear family, you know, husband, wife, children. Now it's going to become the extended household, particularly if we're talking about Italy. And it makes sense to focus on developments in Italy in that regard if we're going to be talking about the Renaissance. So, you know, often families who were related and very often bore the same name would have lived in the same districts. And the importance of the family in northern Italy was perhaps most evident in the vendetta, right? The idea that a crime committed by one family member fell on the entire family. Or put another way, if somebody harmed a member of your family, you were duty-bound, you were obliged to avenge them, ideally against the individual who had committed the crime, who had harmed your family member, but next best thing would be just getting someone belonging to that individual's family. And we've seen this before, right? This is very similar to how things worked among the Germanic tribes when they first came into Europe. So as you might imagine, that can often lead to a blood feud. Probably the most famous example of that would be the story of Romeo and Juliet, where you have, you know, two individuals from, you know, the boy and the girl coming from families that are in a blood feud with one another and who fall in love. And of course, it ends very tragically. And so that would have been frowned upon in that case, not just because of, you know, the fact that there was a vendetta between these families, but also because marriage wasn't really about the individual. It wasn't about falling in love with someone. Marriage was about the family. It was a means of mobility. So, for instance, if you have a wealthy family, if their daughter is about to get married, that means that they can offer a large dowry, which means they might be able to marry her to a man of higher status, thus elevating the entire family. They get to move up in society. And that usually would have been the rationale behind any decision about who to marry your daughter or son to. And related to that, marriages were in fact generally arranged, often well in advance, right? I mean, the marriage might be arranged when the children were still 2 or 3 years of age, and then would have been reinforced by a legally binding marriage contract, right? So there literally would have been a contract obligating these two individuals, originally signed when they were 2 or 3 years old, so they obviously had nothing to do with that decision, but they are now obligated to become married. And whether they like each other or love one another is completely immaterial. So I mentioned, when we get to the Renaissance, we're focusing for the most part on Italy. We'll also look at developments in Northern Europe around Flanders, what's often referred to as the Northern Renaissance. But by way of providing some background leading up to the Renaissance, we should learn a bit about the political situation in Italy coming up on the Renaissance. So you have a number of different city-states, but there are five major states that really stand out that were probably the most important, the wealthiest, and the most influential. These would have been the Republic of Florence, which you can kind of see there a little bit above the center of the Italian peninsula in a kind of beige pinkish color. The Papal States in yellow in the center, centering around Rome, and that would have been politically controlled by the Pope. The Kingdom of Naples, that made up the southern part of the Italian peninsula, which for the most part would remain an agricultural state. The Duchy of Milan in light blue in the north, and they would have become pretty wealthy. And then finally, one of the wealthiest city-states in Italy, the Republic of Venice, which you can see in green. So just a few words about each in turn. The Duchy of Milan, dominated by two families in succession. First, the Visconti family that ruled until 1447, and then following them, the Sforza family. A very highly centralized territorial state. These families pretty much ruling almost as dictators, but very wealthy. They had a very effective system of taxation, and that generated high revenues. And so later on, they will become patrons of some Renaissance art, not quite on the same level as Florence. But for instance, Leonardo da Vinci will take up residency there at some point, which is, for instance, why the if you want to see his painting of the Last Supper, you have to go to Milan. If you're wondering about the structure you see here in the picture, that is the Galleria, which is adjacent to the cathedral, and that would have been a very important center of trade. Today, it's pretty much where you go if you're looking for a McDonald's hamburger. Republic of Venice. Well, Venice, of course, very famous for its canals. There, you're going to have an oligarchy made up of merchant aristocrats, and as we've already learned in previous lectures, extremely wealthy, right? A very huge commercial empire that they create with trading posts throughout the Mediterranean, the Islamic world, the Black Sea area, and so forth. At some point, having their own navy. So really qualifying as an international power for quite a while. And so, again, it's a good example, too, of how, you know, as a city-state, there is the city of Venice, but they also control a fair amount of territory around the city. So effectively a territorial state. And a lot of that territory used for growing food, but also to safeguard its food supply and overland trade routes, and very often in conflict with Milan and Florence, right? So, you know, this is where we see a kind of balance of power kind of situation emerging where all of them trying to keep the others in check. And then we have the Republic of Florence, which dominated the region in Tuscany. Again, governed by a small merchant oligarchy, but one wherein one family in particular is going to be extremely dominant, and that is the Medici family, starting with Cosimo de' Medici, who in 1453 took control of the oligarchy. Now, they would maintain a republican form of government for appearance's sake, so you'd have kind of elections, You know, there were other individuals that were part of this oligarchic structure that governed, but pretty much everyone taking their lead from the Medici family. And of course, probably most famous for, you know, being the biggest patrons of Renaissance art and turning Florence into the cultural center of the Renaissance. And here you see a beautiful picture of Florence. And, you know, it's kind of one of the more famous scenes from Florence where you have this bridge with many structures on it. And to some degree, kind of an indication of the wealth of Florence, right? Florence would become very wealthy, much as Venice. The Papal States, nominally under the authority of the popes. We should note in the period leading up to the Renaissance, you had what's known as the Great Schism, the details of which are covered in the textbook reading. But that had seen the popes temporarily relocated to a city in France, in Avignon. During this period, the popes lost a lot of territory in the center of Italy that had been under their authority. You know, remembering also, right, the pope has spiritual authority over the church throughout Europe, but had genuine political authority over the Papal States. So they had lost a lot of territory, including some that were considered important, like the city of Urbino. And so coming into the Renaissance, a lot of the popes were really focused on kind of reasserting their authority in the center of Italy, you know, recapturing some of this territory. In some cases, the popes would even be leading the army. I mean, they would literally be out there at the battlefront. One of them, Julius II, who would very famously become an important patron of Michelangelo, but often referred to as the warrior pope. So that kind of gives you an idea of what's going on with the Papal States during the Renaissance. And then finally, the Kingdom of Naples, which often kind of being fought over between some of the larger, more important dynasties in Europe, particularly the French and the Aragonese based in Spain. But eventually the Aragonese would become dominant there by the mid-15th century. And we should note, Naples never really a very active player in the Renaissance, culturally speaking, usually seen as being kind of backwards, mostly dominated by poverty-stricken peasants. So you don't have really much development in terms of trade and commerce, meaning also not a lot of wealth being produced, therefore, you know, no disposable income that you might use in order to patronize Renaissance art. So as you can see, Italy very politically fragmented coming into the Renaissance, and related to this, very often subjected to a fair amount of warfare, often a lot of conflict, sometimes between these city-states, but also as we see the growth of powerful monarchical states in Europe, Italy often becoming the battlefield between their great power struggles, particularly between the Spanish and French, not least in connection with the Kingdom of Naples, as we already referred to. And part of the problem is because Italy is divided into so many city-states, and different regions, and Italians tending to feel, you know, really their primary loyalty to their cities and regions is very difficult for them to ever come together into some kind of alliance by which they might have resisted and repelled foreign invaders. One arguably positive development to come out of this would be the birth of the modern diplomatic system. So this is actually worth highlighting, given that much of how international relations happens today in terms of diplomacy, in terms of the role of diplomats, ambassadors, inherited from these developments, going back to the Renaissance in Italy. So it kind of started with Italian states sending resident ambassadors to neighboring states, you know, ostensibly to represent the interests of their government, to speak on its behalf. But also with the idea of ferreting out information, right, to kind of act as spies. But probably the most valuable thing is it really provided a channel for communication between states that really could help avoid conflict, for instance, you know, or at least by way of, you know, letting another state know what your intentions were and so forth. And for, you know, just maintaining kind of a continuous communication between states. In any event, this practice very quickly spread throughout Europe, And much of the diplomatic machinery that developed during this period is really still very much in place even up until now. For example, the rights of ambassadors in host countries, if we think about things like diplomatic immunity, the idea that a diplomat is not subject to the laws of that state, but also regarding what are considered proper procedures for carrying out diplomatic business. And probably most important in terms of what the purpose of an ambassador or a diplomat is. If you're appointed as an ambassador or a diplomat, you understand that your primary goal is to serve the interests of the state you represent. To preserve it, right? To ensure that it doesn't come to harm. Back in the day, it might have also included the aggrandizement of your state, acquisition of territory. But again, the primary thing being that your responsibility as a diplomat, as an ambassador, is to look out and promote the interests of the country you represent. And that reflects the idea that the state comes first, even before your own individual interests. And if we're going to talk about political developments in Renaissance Italy, we definitely have to make mention of Niccolò Machiavelli, who himself was a Florentine diplomat, made numerous diplomatic missions, not just within the Italian peninsula, but also to France and the Germanic lands. I wrote Germany there, but there is no German state at this point, just to remind you. Eventually actually was forced into exile, had actually kind of got into trouble with the Medici family, who for a very brief period of time had fallen out of power. But when they came back into power, they basically forced him to leave. And that, basically left him with a lot of time to reflect on the nature of political power. Related to which, he would write what is probably the most influential political tract of all time, a book called The Prince. So up until this point, political power was justified largely on the basis of the Christian faith, that a king ought to behave based on Christian moral principles. Kind of the ultimate objective was to unite Christendom under one rule, one ruler and so forth. Machiavelli is kind of looking around him at the reality on the ground and basically rejected this as so much pie in the sky, right? So he offered in its place what he considered to be a realistic assessment of how politics actually worked, right? So he basically argued that a prince's attitude toward power must be based on a realistic, often very cynical understanding of human nature, right? That if people are permitted to do so, they will try to take advantage of you, right? That they often respect more power, right? The threat of punishment than respond to kindness and love, right? And so, this kind of realistic understanding of human nature is what should guide their actions. Furthermore, the prince's first obligation is to act on behalf of the state. And here we can really understand that he is coming from a diplomatic background. Related to this, in serving the interests of the state, the ends always, and this is the cynical part, the ends always justify the means. As Machiavelli put it, he should do what is right if he can. I mean, if you don't have to do something negative, then by all means, do the right thing, the moral thing. But you must be prepared to do wrong if necessary. Kind of the idea, if you don't have the stomach for that, you're in the wrong business. You should not be ruler. In order to rule effectively, which means to rule on behalf of the interests of your state, you have to be prepared, shall we say, to break a few eggs, right? So this book has continued to influence political theory even up until now, right? And, very often we even talk about people who we say, oh, they're very Machiavellian, right? Meaning that they can be very ruthless, right? This kind of, again, ends justify the means. By way of kind of wrapping things up, we might look at intellectual developments in general, which reflect a much different kind of attitude about human behavior, that actually see human behavior in a much more positive way. And this is a movement known as humanism. So this is also perhaps the last really important factor in laying the foundation for the Renaissance, in as much as it would really define the outlook of most Renaissance artists. Right, so really at its heart, it's a literary movement emphasizing individualism and secularism, but all of it tied to the idea that human beings are essentially good. and that if they behave wrongly, it is simply because of a faulty education. If people are properly educated, they will be good people. They will be moral people. And kind of the idea, they really believe that humans have an infinite capacity for goodness, right? And, you know, again, when we get to Renaissance art, I think it will be apparent in terms of how human beings are depicted that they have a very positive understanding of human nature, right? So very important in this regard, you know, this intellectual movement will be the aforementioned Petrarch, who is probably the ultimate humanist, right? He studied, and so he's, first of all, going to very actively promote the idea of a secular education centered around the classical literary works of ancient Greece and Rome that emphasize grammar, rhetoric, poetry, moral philosophy, or ethics, and history. So as you can see, there's not really much there by way of a proper, quote-unquote, religious education. Maybe tying in a bit with moral philosophy, but a lot of the ideas that they promote in connection with morals or ethics, not really tying directly into the Bible, not contradicting the Bible, but they don't find their point of origin there. One very important part of humanism is going to be civic humanism, something that really becomes prominent in Florence. And so kind of the idea that part of being good is also devoting your time, energy, and capabilities to the community amongst which you live, right? So in a sense, putting the state first, but not in the sense of being prepared to visit harm upon enemies, but rather promoting the good within your community. And this becomes really something very much tied to government service, kind of the idea that if you're working for the government, you should be motivated by a sense of civic pride, right? That you should be, and in fact, all intellectuals to some degree, you know, whatever your focus is in terms of your learning, kind of the idea of how you can apply that to the benefit of humanity, particularly those amongst whom you live, right? The study of humanities should be put to the service of the state. And correspondingly, many humanists would actually serve in government as chancellors, counselors, advisors, and so forth. You know, so a really important thing here to kind of summarize it, not just the idea of kind of emphasizing the value of learning, but that learning shouldn't just be for its own sake, right? That you use that learning in order to make society better, right? In the interests of your state. And so I mentioned at the beginning of our discussion of humanism that to a very large extent, their ideas were influenced by classical learning from the ancient Greeks and Romans. And this is going to become more pronounced coming into the second half of the 15th century, particularly with respect to Plato and those who came after him who were influenced by him, what we might call Neoplatonists. And you might remember the big thing with Plato was this idea of ideal forms, right? That everything we see around us is a manifestation of some kind of perfect ideal form. Well, they're going to try and use some of these ideas to explain the nature of God. You know, God the Father is the ideal form. Jesus, in a sense, a manifestation of him on earth. So trying to use Greek philosophy in order to explain you know, certain theological concepts related to Christianity, and really trying to synthesize these two things into a single system. Not everyone in the church is going to be happy with this, particularly to the extent that it would even seem to lead to a kind of polytheism, or, you know, what we conventionally think about as a belief in multiple gods and goddesses, something that becomes evident with what's known as Hermeticism. This kind of approach that stresses occult sciences and certain theological and philosophical beliefs related to pantheism, the idea of multiple gods and goddesses, right? So it's basically the idea that the divine, i.e., you know, somehow God, exists in nature, that God is manifest in all living things, maybe even unliving things, human beings, of course, being the most important, that all human beings have a spark of the divine in them. But you can see how this could be viewed as a kind of paganism or a kind of polytheism, a belief in multiple gods and goddesses, right? Because kind of the idea that there is something divine in all the different elements of nature around us, and that could very easily correspond to, you know, the idea that they are gods and goddesses, but maybe, you know, they are all connected because they all somehow reflect a manifestation of some overarching greater God. In any event, right, this ties in most importantly with the idea that humans are essentially good because we have the spark of the divine in us. And that means that at our core, our nature is good. And this is a very, very different perspective than that of the medieval period, which saw man in a largely negative light. We are essentially, you know, the view then was that mankind is essentially sinful. That is why Jesus died on the cross to atone for our sins, because we are beyond our own salvation. We cannot achieve salvation by our own merit. What's now being proposed suggests perhaps otherwise. And humanism ultimately again about education, because if we are essentially good, then you have to explain why do we often do bad things. It is a matter of education. People behave wrongly because they are not properly educated. Nobles only appear superior to commoners because commoners are not educated. Bearing in mind, when they talk about behaving in a proper manner, very often corresponding to what today we might call proper etiquette, right? So just, you know, not simply just right and wrong as we think of it today, but also knowing how to behave around other people, right? And so humanists believe that human beings could be dramatically changed by education. And so they're going to develop their curriculum, which again is very secular, based on this idea, right? This kind of focus on the liberal studies, or so we might call it today. These were the key to freedom. These would enable individuals to reach their full potential. And so, you know, by the way, they even experimented with this idea by educating a small number of children from the lower classes. In spite of, you know, all this rhetoric, the fact of the matter is that education was still primarily for individuals coming from the noble class, right? But they did offer this education to a small number of children from the lower classes by providing free educations. The idea was just kind of seeing if their theory was correct. They even went so far as to educate a few women, primarily of noble background. But this was still, you know, a very rare occurrence, right? But, you know, again, this kind of ties in with what we talked about with Christine de Pisan, the idea that if women do not behave in an appropriate way, they seem irrational, emotional, et cetera, all these stereotypes. She had argued it's because of not having access to an education, obviously finding a correspondence with what the humanists are saying here. And related to this, very important for humanists would be the study of history. But they're using history in a different way. Until this point, history was primarily about, you know, trying to understand God's plan for humanity and tended to emphasize miracles, divine intervention, things of that nature, or to interpret past events in terms of whether they are helping to fulfill God's plan. They're using history in a different way. They want to better understand human behavior and therefore to understand why people did what they did in the past, what worked, what didn't work, and so forth. So they're going to really reduce and to some degree even eliminate the role of miracles in historical interpretation. And then corresponding to that, much greater emphasis will be given to documents, what historians call primary sources, and then related to that, developing the needed critical skills in order to properly examine them, to interpret them. So from the point of view of the discipline of history, humanism, a very important development. We should also know humanists beginning to think in a more linear way about the passage of time, which might seem self-evident, right? You know, there's past, present, future, very distinct things. But very often in other cultures, other times, the passage of time has often been thought in a more cyclical way. It's repeating itself. So they don't really see it that way. Something reflected in how they conceived of their own period as a distinct age. The term Renaissance, of course, self-named, right? This is a term not invented by historians after the fact, but used by intellectuals living at the time, literally meaning a rebirth, the idea that they were picking up where the classical world of the ancient Greeks and Romans had left off. And in fact, they came up also with the term Middle Ages to define the period in between. We conclude this lecture with a very important question, which is, it's very interesting to find out what various intellectuals during a given period were thinking, but you know, you have to ask the question, how influential were they? how pervasive were these ideas? I mean, they are writing them down, but do people really have access to them? How many people can read? I mean, what is the literacy rate during this period? To be sure, the vast majority of Europeans are still illiterate. But I would highlight two things here. First of all, we have this growing social group, the bourgeoisie. These are literate individuals, individuals who are actually very much interested in learning about new ideas. Reading is a kind of entertainment, in fact. The second thing is, and this is where we started the lecture, the development of vernacular literary languages. So we now have written languages that regular folk actually know how to read, presuming they can get their hands on something written in it. And that brings us to the invention of the printing press. You now have the possibility of mass producing literary works, particularly these, those reflective of the ideas that we've been discussing related to humanism, for instance. So very often we attribute the inventing of the printing press to a fellow named Johannes Gutenberg from Mainz, a city in present-day Germany. I've actually been there. You can visit the Gutenberg Museum and learn all about the history of the printing press. It's a little bit unfair to say he invented it. It might be more correct to say that he kind of finished the process by which it was invented, kind of brought it to completion, roughly between 1445, 1450. The first printed book, the first proper, fully printed book would have been Gutenberg's Bible in 1455. The whole idea of the printing press, movable type, right? You can, print thousands of copies of a page, then you change the type, print 1,000 copies of the next page and so forth, and then eventually bind these pages together into books. So the fact of the matter is, very quickly, you're going to have kind of the mass production of books. This is a dramatic change from how things worked during the Middle Ages, where you would have a limited number of copies of any one book, all of them hand-copied by monks for the most part, maintained in scriptoriums, in monasteries, which also would have limited access. Now you're going to have the mass production of books. By 1500, more than 1,000 printers in Europe publishing. By that point, you had almost 50,000 titles, not copies, titles, like distinct books that had been printed, 8 to 10 million copies. There is a market for these books, and these ideas will begin to spread, particularly among the bourgeoisie. And these are individuals who, as we move forward, coming up to the modern period, are going to have more and more influence in terms of historical developments. But in any event, we'll stop there. And when we pick up, we're going to be really focusing a lot, not just on the Renaissance, but on Renaissance art. So we'll be looking, among other things, looking at a lot of beautiful papers. In the meantime, do remember to answer the lecture-based questions for this particular lecture.